a trainer of dolphins. But as fate would have it, she would soon join the ranks of world and literature lovers, beginning at Central State. And after she graduated here, summa cum laude, she's even being modest, she was our top scholar the year she graduated, so. Then she earned an MA at Wright State, and after 5 long, hard-fought years, defended her dissertation entitled Moments of Clarity and Sounds of Resistance, Veiled Literary Subversions and Decolonial Dialectics in the Art of Jay-Z and Kanye West, in November of 2016, and earned her PhD. And she now is a visiting assistant professor at Wittenberg University and is teaching African-American literature with an emphasis on the Black musical tradition, Black women writers, rap music, and pop culture-inspired composition courses. And today her talk is titled Singing Blues for Black Bodies, Black Male Killings and Epistemic Violence, examined in James Baldwin's Blues for Mr. Charlie and the Michael Brown Murder Class. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Bell.
All right, good afternoon / evening, everybody. How's everyone today?
Good.
All right, so thank you all for being here today. I'd like to thank the English department for hosting me. You all made me feel like a real visiting scholar, but the reality is that like this is home for me. I spent some of the best 4 years of my life on this main campus. I can't even begin to tell you some of the stuff that happened in the back gym, Foundation Hall, one, cafeteria food, party 7 days a week. So ain't it a blessing? I made it out of Central after all that. No, but seriously, this talk is near and dear to my heart because it sort of represents my having come full circle and of my academic journey. So the title of what I'm presenting is Singing Blues for Black Male Bodies, Epistemic Violence and Black Male Killings, examined in James Baldwin's Blues for Mr. Charlie and the Michael Brown Murder Case. And the epigraph reads, "And may every nigga like this nigga and like this nigga face down in the weeds." And so what I'm presenting is an excerpt from my dissertation. It's a really long chapter, and this is roughly 20 pages here today. And it's slated to be published in 2018 in a co-edited volume on epistemology and literature and ironically feminism. And so I'm like really like entrenched in the revision process, paragraphs all over the place. So if it sounds a bit disjointed, then that's why. And so James Baldwin's Blues is loosely based on the lynching, the 1955 lynching of Emmett Till. And it's about a troubled young man who returns from the North. He returns back to the, he goes back home to the South. He returns to his grandmother, his father, who's a priest or a reverend, and a new love interest. Before he left, the racist mob had killed his mother, right? So he returns to find that the racial climate in Plague Town, USA, is what it's, is the setting. Hasn't changed that much. The white supremacist flag still waves. It's still really emasculating for black male bodies. And so his ultimate goal is to assert himself, to assert his manhood, to prove himself as this autonomous being who's unafraid of the mob. And this ultimately, and his name is Richard Henry. And this ultimately costs him his life, right? And so there's a scuffle that ensues between Richard and his murderer, who's a white man, just a renowned white man in the town. And the people in White Town, it's called White Town and Black Town, they think that Richard has overstepped his boundaries, right, within this racial hierarchy, both literally and figuratively, and this costs him his life. And so there's an actual scuffle that ensues, and even though Richard surrenders at the end, Lyle Brighton still shoots him and dumps his body in the weeds, right? And so Mr. Charlie isn't his murderer, per se. Mr. Charlie represents a collective entity, an institution. Mr. Charlie represents white supremacist patriarchy. And Mr. Charlie is trapped within the fiction of his identity, right? So he's convinced himself that he's this superior being. And Mr. Charlie wants nothing more than to stabilize racial hierarchies. And so I draw parallels between that narrative and the Michael Brown murder case, right? The 18-year-old, just to refresh your memories, teen, unarmed teen killed in Ferguson, Missouri, right, but after a scuffle with the white officer, and Michael Brown does surrender in the end. He raises his hands as a symbolic, you know, gesture of surrender, but to no avail, right? His body was still riddled with bullets, okay? And so, begin with a visual depiction of my argument. This is a chalk etching. You can't see it, but it's called the Jerome Project. And it's by an artist named Titus Kapar. And I went to see it in Cincinnati a few summers ago, and it really resonated with me. And what you're seeing here, like, intersecting geometrical chalk lines of, like, imbricated profiles of Tamir Rice, Trayvon Martin, and Michael Brown, right? And it resonated with me then, and I've used it in my work. And so I started thinking about its socio-political implications. So number one, it represents the ways in which black maleness has been sketched or etched into being and invented, right, discursively and ideologically. And it also represents the ways in which blackness as a whole has sort of signified this undifferentiated mass of flesh to be imposed upon and ultimately destroyed in the same way that these three young men were, but separately, right? And but what we see here is one amalgam figure, when in reality, this is, you know, it represents what we actually see is three different young men who live three separate lives, three different interests, three different cultural identities, right? So to make sense then of the black male, of black male killings across geographical, across time and geographies, is essential to sort of understand this mythologized American black body existing on a historical continuum. So just as Mr. Charlie represents this sort of conflated historical figure, there's also a conflated black male body that's sort of tucked neatly away within the dark American psyche, right? And the irony is that he doesn't exist, but he's reborn over and over again, right? And so we might understand Mike and Trayvon and Tamir as reincarnations of Emmett Till and as the flesh and blood personifications of Richard Henry, fictional Richard Henry. So my presentation is about unpacking why and how the young black male is conflated and sketched into non-being and destroyed, right, by white races. So I'll just spend some time demystifying some of the terminology that I use. My methodology is interdisciplinary. I'm using post-colonial theory, African-American literature, critical race theory, Afro-diasporic concepts, etc. And, you know, you may or may not be familiar with this stuff. So just let me start with the crux, what's most important here, is this idea of non-alterity. And it comes from Frantz Fanon's chapter, The Fact of Blackness, from Black Skin, White Mass, who's, you know, forerunner of post-colonial theories. And so he argues that when, in a colonial context, right, when a Negro body, he says, encounters this colonial gaze, what happens is that gaze zaps the body, and it, you know, it zaps it into objecthood. And so this means that the black body isn't just other to the colonizer, but he's also outside, he's also object, right? So if alterity connotes otherness and difference, then non-alterity is a state of being outside of otherness and difference, right? And so, and this is for the sole purpose of denying subjectivity to the colonized body. Right, and so I'll just give you a quick demonstration. So let's just say, you know, what's your name?
Dawn.
Where are you from?
The Bahamas.
The Bahamas. Oh my goodness. All right. And all right. So let's just say you are. Say it one more time, Dawn. All right. Let's just say Dawn is walking to Wesley one day, one morning, and you know, she encounters me. I'm from Chicago, by the way. Shout out to Chi-Town folks. Okay. So she encounters me, and I understand myself. Like, I see Dawn, and it subconsciously registers to me that she's different than I am, and we're from two different. We have two different cultural identities. I'm from the home of, you know, footwork and six NBA titles, Harold's Chicken, Kanye West, etc. So I understand that she's different and she has a different social context than I do, right? But I understand that I'm also a subject with my own social context. Tell me some things, some cultural stuff about the Bahamas.
Seasoned food.
Seasoned food. What else?
We have a festival called Junkanoo.
Junkanoo.
And that's like carnival, but we got like clothes on.
We
have the same costumes.
Okay. So the point is that it subconsciously registers to her that I don't have access to that culture. And so what happens is that, and you don't say to yourself, oh, she's different than me. It's sort of a subconscious thing. And so what happens is that there's sort of a reciprocal othering, right? And I can't say that my culture, I can't oppress her because I can't say that my culture and my cultural identity is privileged or better than hers and vice versa. But, you know, that's not the way that white supremacy works when it encounters bodies of color. So there's this line of thinking in a white supremacist imaginary that says, I can't allow the black body to be other to me Because that means that I'm also other to that body, and that body understands itself to have its own social identity, cultural background, etc., right? And so that means that there's a level of sameness, which means that the notion of white supremacy is an impossibility, right? And so what I have to do is make sure this body doesn't have access to otherness by positioning it outside of otherness, because otherness grants one access to subjectivity, to personhood, to being understood as a human being. And so so Fanon would say, as paraphrased by another theorist, that the black body is neither I, a subject, or not I, right? Other, he's sort of outside of that polemic. But how do I convince myself that this body is outside of otherness? Well, I can say that it's an object, I can say that it's an animal, I can say that it's, you know, some type of predator or a figment of my imagination, I can reduce it to sociological statistics, etc. So this means that there's no point of comparing myself to this body, it's not human, right? And so if I destroy it, it doesn't matter either, and how I destroy it doesn't matter, okay? So that's non-alterity, right? So it's about making sure that black bodies are outside of otherness so they don't perceive of themselves as subjects, right? As human beings who deserve to live, right? And to exist. And then there's this philosophical concept called being for other, right? So it's a philosophical paradigm that derives from Hegel and Sartre. And it's based on this idea that we need others to validate our identities, right? It sounds perverse, but that's essentially what it is. So for instance, like, I need my students to validate my understanding of myself as a scholar, with expertise in my field, and with the ability to teach, right, the knowledge that I've acquired. And if they don't, then that sort of impedes my understanding of myself as a scholar who can do these things. In a white supremacist context, the supreme white subject must exert his supremacy onto a black object, and the objectification of the black body is what validates the white subject's understanding of himself as supreme. But if the black body impedes this process, then Hegel says, then they gotta duke it out, right? So they have to fight, because you can't deny me my right to recognize myself as the only incarnation of a human being, which means that you have to be object. And then Fanon invokes this paradigm when he describes a black body encountering a white world, whereby a French child yells, "Dirty nigger," or "Look, the Negro," at the sight of a black body. The Negro is stripped of his subjectivity in the sense that for the white child to recognize himself as the antithesis of the dirty nigger, the child can only solidify the superior understanding of himself if the black body is an object onto which the child exerts his superior subjectivity. And so the objectification of the black body is what validates the child's identity. So for my purposes, this paradigm demonstrates the ways that black bodies are relegated to non-alterity, right, outside of otherness, insofar as they must remain objects that validate white personhood, right, humanity, etc. And then we see this being for other paradigm sort of playing out during the violent scuffles in both narratives, okay? All right, then the final term or philosophical phrase is epistemic violence. And epistemology is like how we know what we know, right? And so epistemic violence is a phrase that was not coined, but more so popularized by a post-colonial theorist named Spivak from her article, Can a Subaltern Speak? And what she argues is that marginalized or subaltern people, so people who exist on the margin, right, in her context, so non-Western people, like, they have a knowledge of themselves and they understand their social surroundings, they understand their oppressed conditions. It's just that, you know, those who see themselves as superior deny them that knowledge, and they don't listen to what they have to say. They're silencing them. They're so invested in this silencing project, and because they have the power to do so, their mode of knowledge is privileged, right, over the knowledge that actual subject has about him or herself, right? So essentially, if I understand myself to be a human being, but a white supremacist comes along and I articulate that and silences me and said, "No, you're a predator," then he or she has the right to destroy me, right? Because his mode of knowledge has been privileged over mine, and that's called epistemic violence. And it's really consequential socially and politically because, you know, because there's epistemic violence, that white supremacist has destroyed me, and he's done so with impunity, and he can start a GoFundMe page. So that's all clear. Now I can move on to what I'm presenting today. So this piece is actually focused on the Michael Brown murder case, but I actually start with a case of a different black male killer. Okay. All right, so Laquan McDonald was a 17-year-old Chicago teen who was murdered by then-officer Jason Van Dyke in 2014. The video of his murder, however, did not surface until November of 15. Resurfaced. It revealed McDonald. Hopefully it plays. Uh-oh. Well, you're supposed to be able to see. others. All right, so we revealed McDonald walking hurriedly across the street with a pocket knife in hand, away from a small brigade of police officers until he falls prey to the first bullet unleashed by Van Dyke. McDonald twirls in midair, almost theatrically, maybe you're not gonna see this, before his body hits the pavement. This is followed by a barrage of bullets, 15 more to be exact. Van Dyke managed to unload 16 shots in the span of 15 seconds. Like, this is a true story. It's right here. Believe me, it's just not planned. As the police report disclosed, Van Dyke feared that a boy with a 4-inch pocket knife held in his right outside hand, walking in the opposite direction of his pointed gun, would somehow endanger him. One might claim that Van Dyke had misinterpreted McDonald's actions as threatening his life. But given that McDonald is young and black and male, should we instead understand this killing in the framework of black male bodies being scripted as predators in the minds of white racists and silenced, right? So as an example of epistemic violence. Unfortunately, distorted versions of reality such as Van Dyke's are too damn familiar to us and have come to represent an official reality in this country to the detriment of black and brown bodies. So singing blues for black male bodies like McDonald in the United States would be in a positive response to their predisposal to gratuitous violence at the hands of white racists. This violence often occurs in the most quotidian spaces, so public park, right? Public street, aisle of Walmart. It's usually state sanctioned, incommensurate to the alleged crime committed, and deadly. The recent killings of Laquan McDonald, Michael Brown, Richard Collins III, Trayvon Martin, Jordan Davis, Tamir Rice, Eric Garner, John Crawford, Alton Sterling, Freddie Gray, Walter Scott, Terrence Crutcher, and an infinitely long list of others at the hands of white repressive power structures are testaments to the very material consequences of the oppression of black males in the US. But why are young black males targeted by racist factions? Black men and youth are killed because they are said to be that which they are not, animals and menaces to society, right? But the black male menace, hypersex brute, or as Hillary Clinton dubbed them, super predators, right, are just pathological constructions in a white racist imaginary. And these constructions license repressive apparatuses, such as the police, the prison system, or white nationalist hate group, to destroy black bodies, both male and female. But at the heart of this argument is the destruction of the black male body and examining the ways in which they are held hostage within the realm of non-alterity as objects, predatory animals, disposable matter, and phantoms. I examine how these overdetermined constructions license their destruction and are made possible through silence and practices. And I use James Baldwin's Blues and Mike Brown, the murder case, to paint this picture. All right. So non-alterity examined in Blues through the character of Richard Henry. Right, so I'm examining Richard as personifying this stereotype called the buck. So reducing the black male body to that of a predatory animal is one of many methods of consigning it to non-alterity. But to make sense of white supremacist agents denying the social group of young black males the right to define themselves as holistic, thinking, autonomous subjects, it makes sense to see this through the phenomenon of epistemic violence. So, one philosopher, her name is Chrissy Dawson, she discusses two forms of epistemic violence in the context of preventing the testimonies of black subjects. She identifies one of these silencing practices as testimonial quieting. Dawson argues that there's a failed communicative exchange, in this case, between white subjects and the young black male body, insofar as, in this case, white supremacists, that audience, consistently fails and refuses to acknowledge the black male speaker, in this case, as a knower, precisely because these bodies are confined to objectifying stereotypes. So Dotson insists that stripping oppressed subjects of the faculty of knowing subsequently renders them incompetent. So just to give you a contemporary example, you all have heard, I'm sure, the phrase thought, right? Mm-hmm. And so it represents a social group of young black girls who are sexually, what's a good correct word to use, a fluid, lascivious, whatever you want to use, right? And this may or may not be true, right? And so even if black girls don't identify themselves this way, this is how they are portrayed. And so if anyone from that particular social group is ever sexually assaulted, and she provides a testimony of this, formal or informal, oftentimes that testimony falls on deaf ears because she is sort of held hostage to this stereotype, right, of being sexually promiscuous, right? And then we can see the same thing, the same paradigm sort of happening in hip hop. We see rappers as thugs and what else? Savages, what have you. Right? And so we see rap music then as being devoid of any political utility. Right? And so, like I discussed earlier in the class, so we can make the case that a lot of rappers rap about crime and a bunch of socially unacceptable behavior, because perhaps what they are doing is politicizing crime and articulating the social world around them, unequal distribution of wealth, etc. But their testimonies are silenced because they are confined to these objectifying images, right? So I'm concerned with the very fatal consequence of testimonial quieting, to which both black men and women are subjected. Baldwin's Blues yields a telling portrait of the mythologized American man who has been silenced because he exists in the racist psyche of Mr. Charlie, as the overly embodied, brutish, prototypical animal, despite any self-defining proclamations such as, I'm a man. This Negro materializes on Baldwin's easel, personified in the character of Richard Henry, who actually utters this very statement, but to no avail because he's been silenced. Evidence of Richard's discursive classification as animal can be discerned in his portrayal as the predatory bull. All right, so it's not until after the murder of Richard, he's this dejected, insolent, former dope fiend son of black minister Meridian and Henry, that readers learn of his construction as a predatory animal. Thank you. Baldwin begins to play with Richard's murder off stage. The ghastly opening lines, and this is like the very first thing readers encounter. And may every nigga, like this nigga, and like this nigga, face down in the weeds, are uttered by Lyle Brighton after he has shot and killed Richard, who has again returned from the North as a musician to start anew. So the events hereafter unfold in a series of flashbacks that recount the details of Richard's return to Plague Town to the moment of his murder outside of a black-owned juke joint. The flashback disclose conversations held between the black folks in Blacktown and their white counterparts in Whitetown, and it also provides readers an opportunity to sort of glean the epistemic violence that dissipates throughout Whitetown, namely where Richard is concerned. So in Act One, through a flashback discussion between Lyle Brighton and Parnell Jones, James, the editor of the local newspaper and the liberal friend of both whites and blacks, who's also Mr. Charlie, readers learn that Lyle is unquestionably a bigot. He tells Parnell that he has nothing against colored folks, but in the same breath unequivocally declares, I'll be damned if I'll mix with them. His rationale, quote, I don't want no big buck nigga laying up next to Josephine, his wife, and that's where all this will lead, and you know it as well as I do, end quote. So Lyle's anti-miscegenation anxiety, this idea of the races mixing, is provoked by the return of Richard Henry and consequently by the fear of his white woman being subjected to the mercies of the black male buck, okay? So the trope of the black male buck, it emanates from slavery, right? And so essentially, our black men were reduced to breeding animals to populate the plantations and the production of, and to reproduce labor power for the masters. So they were placed in these cabins and they were forced to reproduce, sometimes with their family members, and then they were called savages and incestuous, etc. But they were seen as sort of hypersex, right? And it was consequential because they were labeled as such, right? And so this stereotype was then solidified more so in popular culture discourse after slavery, particularly in the film, The Birth of the Nation. I'm not gonna play it in the interest of time, I don't think it'll play anyway. But what this film shows, or this particular clip that I've chosen, is a white woman running from this supposed to be black man because it's assumed that he's gonna violate her, right? And that he's gonna sexually violate her, and what she does instead is jumps from a cliff to her death, then to be subjected to this black male animal, or buck, right? And then I do hip hop, and the chapter originally had a bunch of Kanye West stuff in it, and so I left this part in. So we can then make sense of Kanye's line from New Slave, right? Fuck you and your Hampton house. I'll fuck your Hampton spouse, came on her Hampton blouse, right, and a bunch of other stuff. Because he's sort of playing into this buck construction, right? And so he's sort of condemning this new Jim Crow system, but his response is to violate white women because he's playing into this construction. I don't know how conscious it is. Knowing Kanye and who his mother was, it probably was conscious. But anyway, so Lyle Brighton has fulfilled what others perceive to be his duties, quote, both public and private, which Baldwin says, by ridding Plague Town of this menacing animal. In Act Two, friends of Lyle and Joe gather in their homes to expedite Lyle and Joe's anniversary celebration given the forthcoming murder trial. After indulging in bourbon, they all lament the latest shift in racial dynamics in Plague Town since the segregation. The niggers, they all agree, are out of control. They've overstepped the God-intended structure of racial hierarchies. Ellis, a white townsman, informs the group that the Negro's alleged one and only interest is still below the belly, right? As if to quell any incredulity regarding the said sexualized and animalized nature of the Negro. He then informs Joe Brighton that being raped by a nigga is akin to being raped by, quote, an orangutan out of the jungle or a stallion, that either could, quote, do her no worse than a nigger, end quote. In this scene, Baldwin is highlighting a bunch of stuff. So first, for me, he's showing us that, and he might not be doing this per se deliberately, but he's showing us that sort of totalizing conceptions of the black male body as animal are often brewed and perpetuated within intimate convivial spaces inhabited by white working class laymen and not just by scientists, right, who are producing a discourse on, you know, on race and racism. That's to say that silencing practices are and have been established institutionally, we know that, and systematically grounded in quotidian interactions and discourses. The scene is also crucial in that it points to a case of testimonial quieting. Given the denial of Richard Henry as one who possesses the knowledge of his self as a man, a musician, a son, an epistemic agent, right? So, as an epistemic agent. Instead, his animalistic predatory disposition is predetermined before he even gets to Plague Town, right? So it could be noted that superimposing these sexualized animal characteristics onto Richard is not an individual act. Rather, this mode of epistemic ignorance is habitually practiced communally. Reverend Phelps's consoling statement to Lyle, quote, "We're with you and every white person in this town is with you," end quote, is symptomatic of the normalization of anti-black violence and the formation of what's called an epistemic community, an outcome of what one philosopher, Charles Mills, terms the racial contract. According to Mills, the racial status quo needs its own moral and objective, like, system of knowledge or epistemology, right? In Blues, the racist townfolk perceive of the world through their own objective moral compass in terms of, quote, what is objectively good or bad, and this mutual understanding is contractual, end quote. There is, quote, an understanding about what counts as a correct objective interpretation of the world, and for agreeing to this view, one is contractually granted full cognitive standing in the polity, the official epistemic community, end quote. So in other words, they all agree that they see themselves as supreme, that they're supreme, and that the Negro, Richard Henry, in this case, or others, are inferior, and that Richard is the buck, right? Then they're initiated into this sort of white tribe, this gang. So it's no wonder that then that Richard, Reverend Phelps and Lily and all the rest of the folks who were there in their home to celebrate his fulfillment, of a duty. In fact, the narrator says that they were in there singing "He's a Jolly Good Fellow." That all the white townsfolk stand convicted in their support of Lyle, and by extension, the routine eyes, haunting and decimation of the black male indicates a collective concession to the hierarchical relations of subjection between themselves and the Negroes, the predatory sort of stereotype of the black male bug, and to the belief of the said that this animal was incorrigible and cannot become a human, and that his one and only desire is to violate the tribe, the white woman, and the tribe of the civilized white Western men. But the problem is that this version of reality is distorted in the face of the actual subject, and what I leave out of this presentation is all the evidence I lay out that proves that Richard did not see himself as the buck, right? He may have seemed to have sort of acquiesced to that stereotype, but he didn't understand himself to be the buck. He was incessantly trying to prove that he was a man, a human being, etc. But the problem was that the white epistemic community failed to ascertain the truth, right, of this knowledge itself because they had been silencing him. Additionally, if the Negro appeared to behave as the buck, it was because the buck stereotype was socially engineered. That is, there were socioeconomic factors that gave way to the appearance of the buck during slavery, and I'll kind of talk about this. So it's a byproduct of sexual violence and coercion that was inherent in a system of breeding slaves for the reproduction of the means of production. In Richard's case, the white-controlled social order had dangled the white woman above his head like a carrot, a symbol of liberty and manhood, like Eldridge Cleaver talks about, and so on. As a result, he had been made to behave toward this animalized pathology, which we can see in his admission of carrying around pictures in his wallet of white women with whom he had slept while up north, and he even said that he did dream about strangling them, but he never could bring himself to do it. So the point is that you can't create the conditions of my animality and then call me an animal, or you can't create the economic conditions for Mike Brown to have to steal cigarillos and then label him a thief. You can't create the conditions for Laquan McDonald to behave erratically and psychotically and then deem him a crazy nigga out to kill authoritative forces, right? So that's the Yeah, that's not alterity in the sense that the black male is outside of alterity and has no access to subjectivity because he's animal. But then he's also an object. So one other manner to guarantee this imprisonment is by sustaining the static object status of the black body, which plays out during the violent scuffle that unfolds, leading to Richard's murder. Lyle does not kill Richard just because he needs to get rid of, you know, this buck. Their violent interaction in Lyle's store is indicative of Lyle's efforts to instantiate white male dominance and to deny Richard's manhood by securing Richard as a being for other, right, and by extension an object. It also reveals Richard's desperate attempts to evade this dialectic, which proves fatal for him, precisely because he has to remain an object for the myth of the supreme white man to hold true. Jo, Lyle's wife, is also involved, personifying the character, sort of teleos of black male freedom. These details are disclosed in Act 2, when Lyle discusses with Parnell the events that precipitate Richard's murder. So it's coming from him, so, you know, there's reason to believe it, right? So Richard and another Negro student, Lorenzo, are walking down a dirt road when Richard decides to buy a Coke out of Lyle's store for no other reason than to get Lyle's face fixed in his mind, he says, because they had previously exchanged words in Papa D's juke joint, right, the first time that they met each other. So inside of the store, Richard insults the Brightons when they don't have enough money in their register to change out his $20. Business is slow and Lyle Brighton lacks viable economic power as a struggling white merchant. Richard takes advantage of this. Richard used their financial instability to exacerbate the racial tension that underlies this scene. Quote, "You all got this big fine store and all, and you ain't got change for $20? End quote. As Trudia Harris acknowledges, Richard then transposes economic lack into sexual lack. "Stud ain't got nothing. You people been spoofing the public, man." He later then directly signifies upon Lyle's alleged impotence by calling him a ballless peckerwood. Additionally, and decidedly more provoking, Richard makes sexualized passes at Jo, condescendingly admiring her daintiness, her sweetness, and how pretty she is. What is that reminiscent of? Emmett Till. Right. So his flippancy, his performance of brutish sexual deviance, and his refusal to recognize the dominance of Lyle induce violence. Lyle raises a hammer to Richard, and a struggle ensues. Richard is momentarily victorious, since the confrontation ends with Lyle, quote, "on his ass with his woman watching," end quote, which Richard says tauntingly. Richard has in this moment disrupted the being for other paradigm, which places him as object, an animal, that validates the white subject's understanding of himself as human, superior, and dominant. He refuses to do so. In fact, he illuminates the fallacy of the white male as the only true incarnation of man when he yells, quote, "now who was the better man," end quote, to a defeated Lyle Brighton. Richard also mocks the idea of the existence of a superior white race or the said male prerogative to preside over the black animal. Ha ha, the master race. You let me in that white chick's drawers and she'll know who's the master. Ha ha. So not only does Richard reconstruct the social order, where he is not only animal subjected to the whims of a master, but he also deposes of the authoritative figure and substitutes himself in place of the white master, impeding Lyle's ability to recognize himself as autonomous, as all-powerful. You know, Richard deems himself a man, and so he's then a being for itself. He's not a being for other. And at that moment, one who occupies superior standing to Brighton, the struggling merchant, right? So the struggle that ensues is inevitable, for Lyle must safeguard the myth of white supremacy and the master subject, of which he deems himself the ideal materialization, by reducing Richard to object on which to enact his mythic identity. And then finally, Richard Henry simultaneously refuses his object constitution through the objectifying reversal of the look. So he looks back at Lyle, right? And I'll explain that in a second. And in doing so, he disrupts the being for other paradigm, again, outside of the juke joint in the final scene. Just before Lyle shoots Richard, he informs Lyle, "you a man and I'm a man," implying that he's a being for itself. Sadly though, the preclusion of the being for other paradigm is a transient moment of triumph. Lyle Brighton's subsequent actions illuminate Mr. Charlie's unwavering conviction to maintain the animal object status of the Negro, or so outside of alterity, since doing so necessitates the attainment of his own exclusively human and superior ontology, all right? And so Blues for Mr. Charlie, and this, I didn't even know this until I was like writing this, but it was restaged in St. Louis, 2015, in the context of the Michael Brown murder case. And these are actually images from the play that I Googled and screenshotted. So the first one at the top is either an image of Lyle and Brighton's first encounter in the juke joint, or it's the image right before he shoots him. I can't tell, but I think it's the former. And so what this represents is the reversal of the look. He's sending the look back to him. And Sartre says that the reversal of the look is self-affirmation. So he's affirming himself as a human being. But that's a problem because that means that Lao can't be the only human being. So he impedes Lao's ability to know himself. Then at the end, of course, this is the violent scuffle that ensues in the store. And not only does he sort of verbally place himself as superior to Lao, but he also physically, you know, overpowers him. So now Lao can be the all-powerful male as he recognizes himself, right? And so Richard has sort of transcended this being for other object or a dialectic, which needs him to be the object, right? And so he has to die. All right. It stands to reason that Lyle Brighton had, quote, had to kill Richard, right? Lyle was left no other choice but to destroy and dispose of the expendable animal that threatened the natural hierarchy of the races. He justifies this classifying logic, producing his final rant to Parnell, quote, I'm a man, I'm a white man, can't nobody talk to me that way. I had to go get my pickup truck and load him in it. I had to carry him on my back and carry him out to the weeds, and I dumped him in the weeds face down. These lines also authenticate, end quote. What one post-colonial theorist, Achilles Mbembe, says is a distinctive feature of the sovereign colonial order. According to Mbembe, quote, the colonized may be destroyed as one may kill an animal, cut it up, cook it, and if need be, eat it. And as for his or her death, it mattered little, end quote, since the black body was what he calls disposable raw material. So that becomes a third way in which the black body is placed outside of non-alterity. It's raw material and expendable. So Lyle's mindless disposal of Richard proved that he was nothing but a disposable raw material. So once again, outside of, non-alterity, outside alterity. Animalized phantasm, cognitive dysfunction in legal discourse. Richard Henry's non-alterity designation continues posthumously, demonstrating a legal discourse surrounding his murder, since he's reduced to this sort of phantom non-presence. The only instance in which his identity is sort of materializes in court is when Joe Brighton fabricates the events that unfolded in their store by informing the jury that, quote, Richard was like an animal, I could smell him, end quote. But even then, he's not only reduced to animal, additionally, she does not actually see Richard. His legibility occurs via his construction as phantasm. She conjures the events with enunciative difficulty. Quote, I give him two cokes and he tried to grab my hands and pulled me to him, and he pushed himself against me real close and hard, end quote. Of course, since these events are relayed through an omniscient narrator during an earlier flashback, readers know that Richard never physically accosts Joe Brighton. Mrs. Brighton's delusional testimony can be diagnosed, according to one philosopher, Charles Mills, as cognitive dysfunction, evidence in the disruptions of her speech. So cognitive dysfunction is a sort of mental incapacitation, and for this case, it allows white racists to fabricate events. According to Mills, cognitive dysfunction is socially and psychologically functional. Why is that? Well, she convinces herself of Joe's predatory behavior in that moment, since the narrative she conjures during her cognitive recall is consistent with the overdetermined or over-embodied construction of the black male body prior to Richard's death and even his birth. Hell. But more than this, if it's one's willful ignorance that enables blackness to be perceived through this lens of animality, then Lyle Brighton was well within his rights to destroy this animal, wasn't he? Joe Brighton conveniently assumes an irrational, mental, incapacitated state that enabled her to see the black body morph into a predatory animal. By this logic, Richard Henry is a predatory, what's called phantasmagoric absent presence in Joe's imaginary. And as I will soon discuss, this form of epistemic violence replicates across historical and spatial contexts. In short, the very fact that Richard's pursuit of manhood undid him is revelatory of the fact that Mr. Charlie murdered Richard's eon before Lyle Brighton put two slugs, quote, in his belly and dumped his body in the weeds, end quote. We must impute responsibility on the racist episteme of the time for imprisoning Richard within the psychic confines of non-alterity. It appears as if Lyle Brighton's presaging wish for other niggas like Richard Henry to share their same fate comes to fruition, and that many other niggas in succeeding decades are beaten or murdered by white supremacists, and Michael Brown is a case in point. All right, so non-alterity. It's no wonder then that the St. Louis Repertory Company restaged Blues in St. Louis in 15, directed by Ron Himes, which included echoes of the Michael Brown murder case in 15, Since there are so many parallels between both narratives, below I highlight some of these epistemic injustices, right, which are replicated 50 years after the publication of Blues in Ferguson. So in August of 14, 18-year-old Michael Brown was a resident in Ferguson, a predominantly black, economically impoverished suburb of St. Louis, wherein its inhabitants, particularly in the neighborhood that he lived in and was murdered, grossed an average of $27,000 annually, quote, making it the eighth poorest census tract in the state, end quote. At the time of his murder, only months after high school graduation, Brown was not employed, but he's preparing to attend trade school. Nevertheless, he was also silenced and scripted by white racist society as deviant and quite possibly an unproductive citizen subject in the consumer culture, which is, you know, an integral element of the capitalist infrastructure. So it was alleged that prior to his execution by then officer Darren Wilson, he was captured via store video camera in the act of a petty theft. After reputedly shoving a resistant store clerk, he ran out of the convenience store without paying for cigarillos. His ensuing encounters with Wilson also illuminate the confinement of black maleness to non-alterity, exemplified vis-a-vis his construction as dialectical object, predatory monster figure, and as disposable mass of flesh. So let's talk about being alterity as it unfolds in this case. I'm sorry, being for other. The being for other struggle for identity discussed above also plays out in the case of Brown's violent interaction with Officer Wilson and unmasked the racist positionality of the black body as animal object in a perverse dialectic. According to witness reports and the statements provided by Dorian Johnson, his friend who was with him at the time, Brown and Johnson were traveling in the street when Officer Wilson demanded that they, quote, get the fuck on the sidewalk, end quote. Brown declined the officer's hostile directive, explaining that they would exit the street when they reached their nearby destination. Now I imagine that his response was just as abrasive. Brown refused to acknowledge Wilson's conscious awareness of himself as supreme subject himself, which would have been validated by Wilson's ability to regulate the movements and behaviors of those animals that are external and inferior to him, in this case, the spaces that those animals are permitted to occupy. Wilson responds aggressively, for invoking Hegel, he had to supersede Brown's ability to threaten his lordship, right? Just like Lyle Brighton had to destroy Richard Henry following his unsettling of the being for other paradigm. Like Richard, Brown, however, allegedly squares up with his opponent, returning not only the look, but physical blows as well. In so doing, Brown substantiates his presence as a being for itself, identity, via purported redemptive blows to Wilson, which have deadly and incommensurate consequences. For Brown must remain this sort of fungible object, right? And so Officer Wilson, the prosecutors, and the media were unrelenting in stripping bare Brown's humanity to unveil what one op-ed writer refers to as the, quote, monster within, end quote. The omission of Brown as a son, a grandson, a brother, a recent high school graduate of Normandy High School with plans to attend college, and as a teen with aspirations to be a music artist, underlies the perfidy of Wilson's testimony. It is another case of testimonial quieting as well. Brown's artistry is recast in the context of deviance, and he is spoken for as a decultured, natally alienated, overly embodied monster. He was tall and big, and what's worse, he made rap songs. Accordingly, Wilson was well within his rights to destroy this rapping monster animal thing because, as he informed the grand jury in his testimony, quote, it looked like a demon, and it looked like he was almost bulking up to run through the shots, right? So this is the person who was present that day, but this is who Wilson saw, right? And again, so he had already been indoctrinated into this sort of epistemology of ignorance, right? Which a Baldwin actually allows us to see. So the incredible hope-like monstrous construction of Brown is produced through and by a racist episteme and suggests a deliberate ontology is the state of being misinterpretation. Wilson imaginatively recalled the events through the same racially saturated field of visibility, that's a quote from Judith Butler, as Joe Brighton, and Laquan McDonald's murderer, Jason Van Dyke. Sure, in this case, Michael Brown had at one point allegedly advanced toward his assailant, whereas Richard's assault against Joe Brighton is verbal, but after realizing that his fists were no match for Darren Wilson's semi-automatic handgun, which held 12 rounds in a magazine, Michael Brown purportedly froze in place with his hands raised. In feedback, a song on rapper Kanye West's most recent album, The Life of Pablo, West adds to the emerging discourse surrounding the details of Brown's murder in rap culture. Hands up, hands up, like the cops taught us. Hands up, hands up, then the cops shot us. Undoubtedly, West is highlighting the semiotic paradox that exists between repressive forces and black bodies. He is suggesting that a non-threatening posture, like Brown's raised arms, a non-verbal signal for officers to de-escalate, did not impel the officer to withdraw his weapon and to instead consider preemptive measures that will result in the preservation of life. I argue that Wilson's murder's resolve owed to his state of phantasmagoria, to will cognitive dysfunction that allowed him to misinterpret the unarmed 6'4", 200-plus-pound teen as a fantastical monster with superhuman qualities. Michael Brown was present on this day, but the Incredible Hulk monster was not. It was a phantom in Wilson's racist imaginary. Not surprisingly, Wilson's dehumanizing testimony is not an isolated case. So Judith Butler examines examination of the Rodney King case as, or Rodney King as a phantom in the imaginary of his assailants is a case in point. Just like Richard Henry, Butler maintains that Rodney King is, quote, the phantasm that white racist violence ritualistically produces at the sight of the racialized other, end quote. And then political scientist Robert Gooding Williams recounts the testimonies of the perpetrators in Rodney King's beating, which mirrors Wilson's testimony in light of his fantastical description of Brown, and Joe Brighton's recounting of Richard's actions in the store. He writes, the defense attorney elicited testimonies from King's assailants that depicted King repeatedly as a bear and as emitting bear-like groans. In the eyes of the police, and then again in the eyes of jurors, King's black body became that of a wild, Hulk-like, and wounded animal whose very gesture threatened the existence of civilized society. The point is that it is only in animalized or monstrous visibility that the black male body is seen. No different than Lyle Brighton, Darren Wilson has fulfilled his duty by dumping 6 rounds into the flesh of Michael Brown. Ridden Ferguson, of one of many monstrous invasions, as well as protecting the monolithic tribe of a civilized white Western man from this animal who sought to dismantle the tribe's mythic identity. Brown's postmortem images, widely circulated in the media immediately and long after his death, speak to his expendability as disposable object. Michael Brown was left face down on the pavement rather than in the weeds, as was the case of with Richard Henry. Notwithstanding his mother's desire for her son's corpse to be removed from the scorching Ferguson asphalt, he remained a spectacle for 4 hours, a mere hyper-visible yet invisible mass of disposable flesh. Comparatively, as monstrous animal body thing, Mbembe argues that in the colony, the quote, corpse remained on the ground, a material mass of mere inert object consigned to the role of that which is there for nothing, end quote. The difference, however, is that in the Ferguson, Missouri 21st century context, Brown's cremating body served the justificatory agenda of the white power structure. That is, for the repressive state apparatus on site, similar to Richard's body, Brown's was reduced to a black mass of evidence needed to legitimize white impunity and as evidence of what happens when one does not bow to authority. To conclude, the enactment of corrective political legislation cannot serve as a sole antidote for the destruction of black bodies. Under the current political leadership, seems an impractical response anyhow. Rather, any subversive strategy must begin with an in-depth understanding of the ideological constitution of the black male body and a racist psyche, given that the absence that it conjures paradoxically manifests itself as a ubiquitous presence, thereby silencing the black male's initial knowledge or perception of self. We must weep for Emmett Till, the fictional Richard Henry, Rodney King, Michael Brown, and Laquan McDonald. For their cases all signify a historical stasis. The black body has been confiscated, as George Yancey argues, by the unchanging white racist episteme of every era. He is victim of egregious testimonial quieting. His identity has been returned to him as non-alterity, as one relegated to the static ontology, in such a way that he is predatory animal, he is perpetual object entrapped in a racialized self-other dialectic, or he is a monstrous body thing that is sometimes dumped in the weeds or left to cremate on the asphalt. I am with the words of Lorraine Hansberry's character, Mama, have you cried for this boy?